piecemeal through the months. Next week, next Sunday is Mother's Day, and so we'll take a break from that, and we'll do Mother's Day, and then I'll pick up for the remainder of the month. But I want to talk on the unknown God this morning. So if you have your Bibles, let's go to Acts chapter 17, beginning in verse 16. Acts chapter 17, beginning in verse 16, and I'm going to read through verse 23. Now, while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection." And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting, for you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now, all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. Verse 22, so Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you today." Amen? In the Greek, the unknown, this part of Scripture is agnostos theos. Agnostos theos. This is where we get our word agnostic from, meaning, you know, the unknown or the unsure. Most people who are agnostic, they don't confirm nor do they deny a deity, but they don't practice and form either. So they're kind of out there still searching for the meaning of whatever. And then theos means God, or it's where we get the word theology. And so this is talking about the unknown God, and so Paul is referring to them. Now, Paul first goes to the synagogue of the Jews. And whenever he went into the city, the first thing that they did was they went to the lost sheep of Israel. And we hear this, we know that because Jesus, that's when he commissioned them, that was the first thing he told them to do. Go to the lost sheep of Israel first. If they receive you, they receive you. If they reject you, they reject you. And then you go to the Gentiles, okay? And so Paul was honoring the commission that Jesus had given him by going into the synagogue. But Paul was perplexed at what he saw in Athens. He saw a nation city. Now, Athens, understand, in ancient times, cities were also states. Not states as we know it, but they were also considered their own kingdoms, their own countries. So Athens, we're not, if you look at on the map, the city of Athens, it's only about this big. But in this time, Athens represented an entire region. Basically, it was the central point or the majority of the country of Greece. So if you were in Athens or you came out of Athens, you were a Greek, okay? And you'll notice that when they talk about cities, they're really talking about geographical locations, okay? And so Athens was riddled full of idols. And Paul recognized this. So even though he went to the synagogue and he's preaching to the Jews, it did not stop him from contending with the population. Because their idolatry was rampant. Their idolatry was so full. Do you know that there's no record of Paul performing any miracles in Athens? There's no record of anyone being converted to Christianity in Athens. There was a subset of believers who had already heard the good news, and they associated with Paul, but Paul was basically there on his own, representing the full gospel of Jesus Christ. And he had to contend with the idolatry that was there. So Athens is riddled full of idols. Petronius, who was a contemporary of Nero's court, he would say this of Athens. It was easier to find a god than it was to find a man. So that gives you, I mean, that's kind of a satirical representation of what was going on. But their idolatry was so full in this region that there were idols everywhere. And so he says it was easier to find a god. And so I'm going to give you some back history just on what Paul had to contend with in this region. And I'm not trying to educate you in Greek mythology or anything like that, but we have to understand why the Greeks were so steeped in this. What brought them to this particular point so that we can understand the atmosphere that Paul was truly facing. And as we walk through this, you'll begin to identify here in 2016 some similarities. So the Areopagus was the hill of Aris or Martis, or in the Latin it's called Mars. So Aris or Ares is the god of war. And so the Areopagus was named after Ares, the god of war. So it's kind of ironic that he's on Mars Hill, which is the Latin, or the Areopagus, which is the pinnacle of war, the pinnacle of contention. And this is where Paul finds himself, with against the High Supreme Council of Court. Now there's 9 archons or chief justices that sit in this court. There are former ex-archons, and if they are of various ages, and the key thing is they are of blameless life. The scriptures talk about the Epicureans and the Stoics, and so back history in that, Epicurus lived between 342 and 270 BC. He taught that the purpose of life was pleasure and freedom from pain, passions, and fears. Cypriot Zeno, which was the founder of Stoicism, he lived from 343 to 265 BC. He stressed that living in harmony with nature and depending on reason and other self-sufficient powers. Both schools of these two men stress the quest for peace of mind. Zeno viewed God pantheistically as the world's soul. So not as an individual deity, but that God was a collective of the souls of the world. Starting to see some things that we face today, right? The Stoics and Epicureans also taught philosophy and religion. They taught it as a system, but not as a stand of faith or a belief of faith. And they spent their time searching out new things in creeds and dogmas and opinions. Epicureanism was a well-known school of atheistic materialists who taught that pleasure was the chief end of human existence. And Stoicism was a celebrated school of severe and lofty pantheists, whose principle was that the universe was under the law of an iron necessity, the spirit of which was called the deity, and that a passionless conformity of the human will to this law was unmoved by all external circumstances and changes, meaning that it was the perfection of virtue. So both of these, even though they were two individual sects, they played on the fact that everything was driven, that deity and virtue and everything that was pleasurable and pain was driven by the human experience. Okay? Now we hear things, and we've been exposed in our modern culture to this thing called New Age, all right, or Eastern mysticism. What people don't realize is there's nothing new about New Age. There's nothing new about Eastern mysticism, okay? This has been going on for hundreds and thousands of years. These men lived 400 years before Christ was born. So when Christ came into the world, New Age was already existent. So it's not New Age, it's just the new version of Old Age. Amen? And so we find that a lot of the same things that these guys were teaching, we still find evident in our schools today, particularly secondary universities. Do you know schools like Yale, Harvard, all of the Ivy League schools, they were established as schools of theology, school seminaries. That's how they were chartered in the U.S. Today, that original charter is pushed aside to a very small college within the university system, and the rest of the university, guess what? It proliferates. It proliferates this kind of thinking. I mean, even now, you know, and Becky will tell you, when she just recently, in the past couple years, finished her bachelor's degree, and I'm in grad school. Even now, you deal with professors that constantly contend with faith. And not only do they just contend with it, this isn't a casual contention. They are blatant. You know, the movie, God Is Not Dead, that's kind of an over-the-top emphasis of it. And that's not really how the majority of the academics, the professors of today, that's not really how they attack the students. They attack them in a very underlying, undertone attack. So as soon as a student says, well, I'm gonna write my paper on this, or I'm gonna write, they're gonna say something like, well, you can write it on that, but don't expect a good grade. You know? I remember my second year composition class. We had to write a paper that was a paper of confrontation, or a paper of conflict. And so I submitted my thesis that I was gonna write on the abortion issue. First time he sent it back, he said, nope, denied. And I'm like, I went back to him, I said, so you're telling me what I can and cannot write? He says, I'm not confident that you can write this paper from an unbiased position. And he said, you won't make a passing grade if you write this paper. And I said, well, I'm up to the challenge, are you? See, I learned a long time ago. If they want to challenge you, then let's go. I'm gonna let my faith speak for myself. And so he says, all right, he says, but you will not make a grade better than a C on this paper. I guarantee it. I'm like, okay. So I did all of my research. The majority of my research was on pro-choice, not on pro-life. Why? I already know pro-life. I can speak on that platform, but what I couldn't speak to was the other platform. What were they standing for? Why were they standing for it? What were the consequences of that? And so I went and did all of my research just on that, and then I presented it. I presented it first. Here's pro-choice. Here's what they say. Here's their defense. Here's the pros of what they're talking about. I'm not saying that I agreed with it, okay? So understand, I'm presenting facts. It's a fact paper. Okay, so I'm presenting the facts that they stand on. So I printed those first. And then I did the pro-life stance. What are our facts? What are the things that we stand on? And then the very last part of my body, of my paper, I wrote on what the cons and consequences of both sides were. And then I summarized my thesis statement in the summary, saying that based upon the facts that I've just written, if I were not a believer, see? Based upon the facts that I've just written, if I were not a believer, the facts would point me to a pro-life stance because of the health and welfare of the mother, the child, the cost in social welfare that is spent after a woman has an abortion is significantly higher. So I presented the facts as well. Not only is it an emotional issue, not only is it a physical issue, not only is it a spiritual issue, but it is an economic issue. He came back, and he personally brought the paper to me. After he handed everyone's off, he says, you need to come see me after class, and I want to talk to you about your paper. I'm like, great. So after class, everyone's out. He puts the paper, he just basically throws it on the desk at me, right? And he goes, I knew I was going to fail you on this paper from the day you said you wanted to write this. And the more I read, the more ticked off I got. Not because of what I read, but because I could not find anything to count off on you. You presented your facts. You had all of your references. You had all your citations. He goes, I never knew this about the pro-choice stance and platform. I never understood it that way. And he said, and you did not interject and interfuse your own moral belief. You stuck to the facts. And he goes, I've never seen a more unbiased paper on this topic than yours. He goes, I have no choice but to give you an A. He has no choice but to give me an A.
Amen.
What's that? In my household, we don't just get A's. We get A pluses, and we get hundreds and tens and hundreds and 15s so that we can graduate summa cum laude and all kinds of stuff. That's with honors, the highest honors you can get. Yeah. So she's a summa cum laude, and I'm a cum laude. So I'm not as good as she is. I know that everyone believes that. I know that I'm not as good as she is. So here's the thing. So this is kind of what Paul was against. Paul is standing there in the Areopagus, and there's really nothing that he can say that these guys haven't already made up their mind. They already have their position, and they're unmovable. What I thought's odd is they held their sessions at night. Nothing good can come out of a session of government or judicial review that comes at night. We know that Jesus was before the high priest. When? At night. Why? Because there's no common witnesses. See, whenever the court is being held during the day, the court is helping. The court is held in open session. So people can see, they can observe, they can see what's going on. Now, he was not tried in open session. Well, same thing here. They held their sessions at night. They took cognizance of murders and impieties and immoralities and punished vices of all kinds. Idleness was included. So if you were idle, you could go to jail. If you weren't productive in this society, you could find yourself being punished. They rewarded or assisted the virtuous and were peculiarly attentive to blasphemies against their gods and to the performance of sacred mysteries. So it was only natural for Paul to find himself before them because he preached Christ. So it's not clear if Paul was standing before them because he was being tried or if he was just standing before them because they were inquisitive. But at some point, they could have made a decision to arrest Paul if he came against their gods. Amen. So it was natural for him to be there. Here's the thing. 5 centuries earlier from when Paul stood there, 500 years before, Socrates was also brought to the very place where he faced his own charges of his accusers. So Socrates is a philosopher. So that tells you 500 years before Paul, this environment of idolatry was there. The Roman Empire would conquer Greece in about 150, 160-ish BC. And so under this time, they are under Roman rule, but the Romans realized that they cannot rule with an iron fist and at the outer areas. And so what they would do is they would have a governor like Pontius Pilate, and they would enlist or basically bribe the local government to exercise the Roman laws. As long as the people in their civic operations and functions didn't come against Rome, then the local authorities could operate however they saw fit. But the Romans had a lot of jurisdiction in what they were doing. And so that's why they were able to do this. So here, the Areopagus also saw that the laws were enforced. They were observed and executed by properly constituted authorities. It could bring officials to trial for their acts while they were in office. It raised objections of all resolutions of the council or of the general assembly. So this was the highest court, even above the legislative body of Greece. So they could bring somebody up if they didn't like what they were saying. The Areopagus also protected the worship of their gods, the sanctuaries and sacred festivals, the olive trees of Athens, and it supervised the religious sentiments of the people, the moral conduct of the citizens, as well as its education of its youth. So that tells you that this group of people that Paul's standing before, they are even greater than what we would look at our Supreme Court. Because today, our Supreme Court only rules on the rule of law and the rule of legislation as it pertains to constitutionality. These guys ruled on that and morality and spirituality. Everything in the land, they had the final say. If they disagreed, then you could go to jail or be executed. So Paul is among some pretty powerful people. So here, if you know anything about Greek history or Greek mythology, then this won't be a surprise. But for some of you, just so that you get an understanding of the gods that they worshipped. So there were 12 primordials, which I thought was really ironic. Most of their levels of deities are in 12s. And we also know that there are how many tribes in Israel? 12. And how many elders, if you know anything about Revelation, how many elders are there going to be? 12. All right. So there are 12 primordials. These are the first entities to ever exist. Of them, there is chaos. Guess what chaos means? It means void. Chaos was the original deity. In the beginning, the earth was without form or shape. It was void or chaos, right? Thought that was pretty ironic. Then his children were Erebus, which is dark, and Nyx, which is night. And we know that there's a difference between darkness and night. There was Aether, which is light, and Hemera, which is day. They had children, Gaia, which is earth, Uranus, which is heaven, Aurea, which is the mountains, Pontus, which is the sea. Another one of Chaos's children was Tartarus, which is the underworld, Eros, which is procreation, and Kronos, which is time. So a lot of these are words that we know, we've heard before, and they are the roots of things. But there were 12 primordials, and these were the original deities that everything else came from. These 12 primordials also, if we understand, they line up with Genesis in the creation. Everything that God created, we have these. And so this is the Greeks' understanding of that. Now, there's also 12 titans. The titans were the primary descendants of two primordials, Uranus and Gaia. So Uranus and Gaia, actually, they were the procreators of the majority of the primordials and all of the other deities that came later on, okay? So they are father and mother, Earth. Okay? All right. So the 12 titans are Oceanus, which is salt water, Tethys, which is fresh water, Hyperion, which is light, Thea, which is sight, Coeus, which is intellect, Phoebe, which is enlightenment, Cronus, which is different than Cronus, which is father, Rhea, which is mother, Mnemosyne, which is memory, Themis, which is justice and order, Creus, and Lepidus, which is mortality. Then there were the 12 Olympians. Now, mind you, this is not all of their gods. These are just the big ones. Okay, the 12 Olympians, these names will sound very familiar, and these are the primary descendants of Cronus and Rhea, which is father and mother. Okay, Cronus and Rhea are the subconscious intellect of the creations of man, and the creations of man in the consciousness of the 12 Olympians, okay, if you understand how all this is starting to work. Zeus, which is the god of gods, Hera, which is queen of gods, Poseidon, which is the sea, Hades, the underworld, Hestia, home, Athena, wisdom, Apollo, prophecy, Artemis, hunting, Eris, war, Aphrodite, love, Hephaestus, fire, and Hermes is the messenger. So all of these will be the under gods of the world as we know it. There were hundreds and even thousands of other lesser gods, deities, immortals, and heroes. And we know some of the heroes, we've read about them, like Perseus and Hercules, right? This is what Paul had to contend with. They have a god for everything. Everything literally under the sun had its own deity that they could worship. The irony of it is they identified 12 deities that had no names. And so they erected this altar in the midst of the city to honor those 12 deities that had no names. And so that is called agnostos theos, the unknown gods that Paul was talking about. So Paul, by himself, he was not traveling with a companion at this time. By himself, in a very hostile environment, at a place that was recognized for war, recognized for absolute contention of all things known to man. So, we don't know, like I said, whether Paul was on trial or not, but it makes perfect sense that he would find himself before these leaders, refuting their idolatry and proclaiming the one true God. Here's the thing, even today, we face a very similar hostile environment in our culture. Not only do we face the historical evolution of mythology, or the historical evolution of Eastern mysticism, or the historical evolution of everything that is contrary to God and contrary to Christ. Those things are out there, and they're very prominent. Do you know that many studies have said that this generation, and when they're talking about this generation, they're talking about the generation that has been identified X and Y. Okay? X and Y. So, if you were born in the 60s, okay? If you were born in the 60s, you were on the beginning edge of the X generation. That's the generation that we were born. And here's why. Because our generation ushered in the technological revolution. Okay? Technology as we know it has only been like we know it for a very short time. Smartphones are less than 10 years old. Texting, phone texting is less than 20 years old. Computers, less than 20 personal computers, right? They're less than 25 years old. What's that?
Television.
Television. Well, television is a little bit older, but let's go about color television. Color television. I mean, I remember we had black and white TV. I remember when my dad brought the first color TV in, you know, and he had to go get a loan for it because that's how expensive it was. And that color TV, man, it sat in the middle of our living room, and it had one of those little clickers, right, that made noise and click, click, and that's how you would turn it on, turn it off, change the channel. Yeah, I know I'm showing my age. My dad would put that clicker and hide it. You know, no one can touch the TV except for him. No one controlled the clicker except for him. So we think about everything that we know has been in a very short time. And that's why they call us the Generation X, because X means, you know, that there is. Let me kind of back up. If who has an Apple Macintosh or an Apple computer in here? Anybody? All right. So the operating system, John, is called what? OS X. X means 10. So in the Apple world, that was the 10th iteration of their operating system. Okay? Since that came out, I guess almost 10 years ago, right? All they've done is made subset editions of X. Why didn't they ever change to 11? Why didn't they change to 12? Why didn't they go to 13? Why? Because there's a significance in the letter X. So when we talk about the X generation that has been identified as the most spiritual generation ever known to man. Exactly. All of us are going, what? They have been classified by Christian statisticians and non-Christian statisticians have all collectively said this generation is seeking after a spiritual life like no other generation before. Why? Because in generations prior to 30, 40 years, all of their activity surrounded around three basic things: church, School, family. They didn't have to go seeking after it because the nucleus of their life and their livelihood, they were born into it. You know, most people were, they were agriculturalists. They were farmers. They weren't industrialists. The entire Industrial Revolution, I mean, it started right at the turn of the century, the 19th century. You know, Henry Ford was really the catalyst for that, the whole Industrial Revolution. But do you know that the impact to our economy and our agricultural economy was only about 15 to 20%? But since the industrialization or the technological movement, the impact to our rural economy, 60 to 70%. People are leaving all of their roots, their simple roots, and they're coming for the most technological advances. And so you have so much information now at the fingertips of a child. A child has more exposure to information than we have in our entire lifetimes. During World War I and World War II, news did not travel very fast. It could be weeks or months to find the outcome of a battle. And some people in the most rural places, it could be almost half a year to a year because that's when they finally got the film to show them in black and white where the war was going. So they had no concept of what was going on because the information, it trickled down to all of the outer areas at a very slow rate. Today, if something happens on the other side of the world will know about it before the media has an opportunity to report on it. Information is so instantaneous. Well, this is why this generation is called Generation X, because in this X, in this extreme advanced technological age, they have everything at their fingertips, and they are searching for something more because you can't find everything you really need inside that tablet or inside that smartphone. You find the head knowledge, but you don't find the truth. You don't find the significant source of who you really are. And so they go run off. But because we, the church, have not done a good enough job of educating, of training, of nurturing the spirituality of people, they don't come to us first. Guess who educates your children the most? Their friends. It's not even the teachers. It's their friends. All it takes is for their friend, one friend, to have a little bit of knowledge of something that's going on in their home, and they're going to tell all their other friends. We don't even get a chance to tell our kids about the birds and the bees. They already know them before we tell them. You know, I think Stephen, we set him down. He's the only one of the three children that still had an innocence because he didn't have the full understanding of what it was. But the other two, oh, they knew. Chris knew at a very young age what things were and how they were supposed to work. I didn't have to have that conversation with him, and I'm petrified. Somebody else is teaching my kid information that is my responsibility, and they taught him wrong. And how do you deprogram that? How do you deprogram a child who has a great relationship with another child, and now I'm going to tell him, well, no, that's not right. Well, guess what? He spends 8 hours a day, 5 days a week with this child. I get him for 3 hours in the evening. We eat, we bathe, we do homework, we go to bed. On the weekends, if because of the way that our world is working in this culture, guess what? I'm working, she's working. Now guess who's educating my child? Well, it's going to be another sibling. Or it's going to be, yeah, a teenager who's watching them. Or the TV. So you think about this. Everybody is educating my child more than I had the opportunity to. That's how our culture has evolved. So it's not a surprise that they realize, I need something more. I have all this head knowledge in here, but I have no understanding of how to apply it. I have no understanding of what it means. I mean, you can get lost in this stuff. I mean, just the things that I presented to you this morning, just that stuff took me at least 40 hours of research. Because the more I clicked, the deeper I went. The deeper the rabbit hole went, to eventually I'm like, okay, I got to dig myself back out of this and find something that I can at least get to a summary. But you can get so deep in this stuff that you literally lose who you are and lose why you're doing this. But Paul stood on the fact, no matter what, that he was going to proclaim the unknown God. We find ourselves a lot of times on trial defending our faith in Christ, but not our belief in God. See, God is known in our culture as a generic religious placeholder, where people can point to or point at. It is this unrealistic notion and fantasy or an unapproachable myth. That's who our God is. We spend a lot of time, you know, focusing on Jesus, and we should. But we don't, and that's where our contention comes from. Do you know that when you tell people if they believe in God, they will tell you they believe in God. But the God that they believe in is not the God that Paul's talking about. The God they believe in is this principle of something out there or something in here. And they'll even say, I mean, you can have a conversation with a person and you can go, man, this person's a believer. They say the same words. We have this connection. And then all of a sudden you get to a point when you say Jesus and they're going, oh, no, I don't believe in that Jesus guy. But all of their understanding, all of their very language is the same language that we would use as it's a connection to God. See, God is not a reality to them. God is this fantasy to them. God is one of two things in our culture. He's either this big old mean thing that you can't see that's just going to cast curses and judgment on people, right? Or he's this beautiful, wonderful utopia thing and it's all just beautiful, you know, rainbows and puppy dogs and I just love God so much. Listen, we see this in a creative coexistence propaganda campaign. Have you seen those? They're little bumper stickers, and they spell out the word coexist in different religious symbols. And to talk about God is really okay. I've never got in trouble for talking about God. Never. But the minute I talk about Christ, that changes things. See, even in our culture, like here, in the Areopagus, in Greece, in Athens, God is just a God among other gods. He's acknowledged, he's honored, he's blamed, he's worshipped, he's blasphemed. Nothing's changed in over 2,000 years. God still endures these things. He's become buried in the cosmos of liberal hyperbole and conservative rhetoric. It's okay to believe in God if you're a politician. Matter of fact, it's to your advantage if you tell people that you believe in God. But when pressed, what God do you believe? What church do you go to? What is your ecclesiastical or evangelical affiliation? That changes things. But as long as we just keep it at, I believe in God, you know, we can possibly get elected. He's no more significant than our smart devices, our luxury cars, our military might, our overvalued wood, stone, and glass facades, or the impotent and empty climb of success to attain the American dream. See, our idols today are not normally brick and mortar or stone. The idols today are the things that we invest all of our time, our energy, and our resources in. Look, I'll admit it. It's difficult sometimes when you get on the computer and you're trying to do something and all of a sudden this notification pops up. You go like, oh, I wonder what they're up to. Before you know it, 2 hours later and you still haven't got your homework done. Or 3 hours later, you still haven't done the laundry or you haven't vacuumed the house, or you haven't done the thing that you set out to do because your God was calling your name. Now, I'm going to pause. I'm not one of those people that say that we need to go out there and announce to the world, I'm going off social media for the next 30 days. I'm going to fast and get closer to God. Almost 100% of the people that I've seen post that, within 48 hours, they're back on. So that's a lie. If you really want to do it, shut down all of your accounts, delete all of your accounts, format your computer, disconnect it from the internet, turn off your internet provider, shut down your phone and turn it off completely, go into your prayer closet and stay there for the next 30 days. Because that's the only way that you're ever going to do that. See, the gods of our culture call us every moment. And I know I'm just as guilty. I get caught up in that stuff too. And all of us, we will find. And if it's not social media, then it could be shows. Well, I got to watch the, you know, Jersey Shore. I got to watch whatever your perfect show is that you have to watch. And you know, before the advent of the DVR, man, we were like, I got to get out of church. My show's coming on. You know? Or, hey, the Cowboys play at 11, Pastor. You're going to cut this short, right? Right? So even before DVRs, man, we were putting everything else on our time schedule so we can get to go watch our perfect and favorite show. Well, now we don't have to. Now we just record everything for the month, and we set aside a day that should be set aside for our family or whatever else we have to do, and we binge watch. Even if that's not worse, you know, maybe my DVR didn't pick up 3 or 4 episodes. Well, guess what? Hulu, Amazon, Netflix, man, they got it. And not only do they have this season, well, they have the last 3 seasons. And so now I'm going to binge watch for the next 4 hours of my favorite show. Now, most pastors, man, they're meddling when they do that. I'm not meddling. I am speaking fact. Okay? I'm not preaching against your favorite show. Trust me, I got a few of my favorite shows, and I'm way behind on those shows. And I get to a point, it's like, you know what? I just don't care anymore. You know, I just don't have enough capacity or bandwidth to do that. I mean, grad school is literally sucking 8 to 10 hours a day of my life. I barely have time for her, let alone have time to sit there and watch TV. You know? What's that? I'm in trouble, I know. So you know, it's easy for us to say, oh man, I'm glad we're not like the Greeks. I'm glad we're not like the Athenians, you know. We don't have gods all over the place. You want, I don't know if I said this one time. I was in a church. And I can't tell you the time frame. I can't tell you where it's at. But I'm just going to say I was in a church, okay? And I was preaching out of this scripture, something along the lines. And I kind of stopped and I looked around the church, the sanctuary. I saw crosses everywhere. And in an instant, I'm like, man, why does that bother me? And so I kept on going. And the very next day, I'm sitting in my office and I was completely arrested and I could not do anything else. I ran into the sanctuary, turned on all the lights, and immediately I felt the Spirit say, tear those idols down. I'm like, what? Tear those idols down. So I went and took down every cross out of the sanctuary. We had a big wooden cross. I got a ladder, unscrewed it from the wall. Went and put them away. As soon as I put them away and walked back into the sanctuary, the room lit up. When I first walked in the room, it was this dark, heavy presence in the room. I removed all the crosses from the room, and the room lit up. You see, there's nothing wrong with a cross. We wear them around our neck. It reminds us of what Jesus did on that cross. But for some people, that cross is an idol. That cross is going to protect them. I can go sin and do whatever I want to do, but as long as I got my cross, Jesus is going to protect me. right? Or sometimes we put the idea not in the cross, but in who made the cross or in who donated the cross. You see, every one of those crosses in that sanctuary were given by people who no longer attended that church, and they left because of non-ecclesiastical, non-Christian church reasons. They left because they didn't like the pastor, or they left for every reason other. And so their presence, I couldn't tell you how many times when people walked into the sanctuary after that, they're like, oh, so-and-so's going to be mad. Why? Well, you took down her cross. Was it her cross, or did the cross belong to the church? See, that's the problem. That's why that cross is no longer in this room, because it was her cross, and it no longer represented what it needed to represent. Man, you're talking about having some church after that. The place was free. Now think about it. In our Christian thinking, we're going, how can that be? Those are crosses. How can a cross? Because people put their all of their worship in this image and not in the man behind the image. Not in what he did, but in what they did by buying that cross and putting it in the church. So yeah, I'm pretty grateful there are no crosses in this church. I don't need a cross to tell me that I'm a believer. I don't need to wear a cross to tell me that I'm a believer, right? And we have to be very careful. I know a lot of people, they wear the Saint Christopher. They wear some saint medallion, and that's supposed to keep them safe. If you wear those, the Virgin Mary, if you wear those, or even a crucifix, if you wear those, I'm not coming against those things, okay? What is that thing to you? Is it a talisman of a sort? Is it a good luck charm? Or does it truly represent and symbolize what he did for you or what's going on in your life? Like even now, you see these athletes. They'll put, Philippians 4 and 6 or whatever it is. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You don't know who my Jesus is. Why would you put that scripture? Why would you say that that's your scripture? Number one, that scripture doesn't mean that you're going to be a very good boxer, or that you're going to be a very good running back, or that you're going to be able to shoot basketball and get drafted by the NBA. That scripture does not mean that. That scripture means that when all hell is against you, your God is with you, and you can do anything because his strength is in you, and it's not your strength. That's what that means. I tell you, give up basketball and see where God is. Give up football and see where God is. Give up the thing that you love, and then you'll actually see your God. Because if we love the thing more than we love our God, it's going to come back and get us. See, we don't know who our God is. Look, nations like Germany and the UK have long embraced extreme forms of religious tolerance to the point that they are almost atheistic nations now. Most Christian missionaries in a period of history before America became what it started to become, they came from Germany and they came from the UK. And now you can't even have Christian music play on the radio because it might offend somebody. You don't have Christian radio stations because it might offend somebody. You can't put Christian bump. We don't realize the freedom that we have. But in these nations, which are supposedly they had the same root and foundation as we did, they can no longer display. When we were in London a year ago, okay, London, England, the little township that we were staying with some friends, when we walked down the street, there was not a single English business. The signs had English words, but they were mostly secondary to their primary language, which was either Hindi or Farsi. Hindi is the Indians, the Hindus. Farsi is the Arabic. And it normally it could be Pakistani, Saudi Arabia, but anybody from that. So all of the business, there was not a single English business down the main street in England. So at best, they've become agnostic. Other religions, and this is a fact, especially, this is a fact that's really hard to swallow. Since 9/11, Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. Since 9/11. In the U.S., Islam is the fastest growing religion since 9/11. A Barna study shortly after noticed that there was an explosion in the evangelical churches. But when they started to dig deeper, it wasn't new conversions, it wasn't new believers that were going into the evangelical churches. It was people who hadn't been in church for a long time, and now they were afraid. They came back into church. And at the same time, larger churches, mega churches, were gobbling up all the little churches because they had all these programs and all these things, and all the little churches were shutting down. The conversion rate in Christianity was about 20%. The conversion rate for the same period in Islam in the U.S. was over 800% new conversions. Listen, the malicious chipping away of a core Christian belief in value and influence has paved the way for other gods to infiltrate the generations at an exponential rate. Remember I said this generation is the most spiritual seeking of any generation? And guess where they're finding solace? It's not in the Christian evangelical church. You've seen, if you watch any movies or shows or you watch the media, the greatest fear in our nation is a homegrown terrorist. A homegrown terrorist is someone who was born and raised right here in Beeville, but went searching after spirituality and couldn't find it in a Christian evangelical church, but found it in a radical religion, and they were raised up in that religion. They were taught community. They were taught love. They were taught all the things that we should be teaching them, and then they're asked to go do something great for their God, and they go do it. We can't even walk across the street. I'm not asking you to go strap on a bomb, okay? But we can't even walk across the street and go tell someone. Man, these guys are dedicated to the death. And they don't care who they take with them. Listen, I'm not glorifying their actions. But man, we got to admire their faith. We got to admire their tenacity. Do you know that the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witness, they demand that their young men go out for two-year missions. 2 years. They submit and commit 2 years of their life post-high school to be a missionary. And if you've had those guys come to your doors, you probably don't treat them the way that I treat them. But I know others do treat them very similar, and they get abused. But they still smile. They get on their bikes, and they go to the next place. They are faithful to what they believe, to what you ask a believer of an evangelical church, hey, we're going to go take some food to this person and hand it to them. Oh, I got things to do. I'm too busy. I can't go do that. Listen, the Antichrist propaganda train is steeped in the same spirit of idolatry that the Athenians were. It's really less about removing God and more about allowing idols and other gods to thrive around him, thereby diluting and neutralizing and disenfranchising his influence or culture. See, we like to stand on the fact that, man, we're a Christian nation. We have the right to religious freedom. And you know what the other side's saying is? Fine, you do have that right. Well, guess what? Now we're here. We have that right too. And we're better at it than you are because you've gotten complacent. And so it's okay, you can have your God, you can have your Jesus, you can have all your little parties and stuff like that. You can stay secluded in the four walls of your church, that's okay, we'll take care of everybody else. The community that you refuse to step out into and to go care for, that's fine, don't worry about it. We don't want to bother you, we don't want to burden you. We're going to go out into that community, we're going to feed the poor, we're going to take care of the widow, we're going to take care of the hopeless. We're going to raise them into community, we're going to show them love, we're going to let them see what a real family is like because they don't know what family is. But that's okay, don't burden yourselves at all. We'll take care of it for you. That's how they're influencing our culture. We look back at the scripture sometimes and say, man, I'm glad it's not like that today. Our enemy, he doesn't have any new material. Y'all know that, right? He just has the same old material. But he's gotten better at how he delivers that material. See, even in the Christian evangelical world, we say, you know what? The message of Christ has not changed, but if our methods don't get to the place where it's truly impacting our culture, then nobody's listening to our message. Our enemy has been very good at delivering the same message he has. He just knows how to deliver it in a different way. He knows how to attract our culture and to bring them in. But we've been so steeped sometimes in, we got to do it this way. I mean, thank God the day we got rid of pews. Thank God the day we got rid of overheads. Thank God the day we got rid of some of the hymns that are not scripturally sound. Notice I said some of them. Some of those hymns, man, they are powerful and they are steeped in scripture and the Holy Spirit moves in them. But some of them, man, we should never sing them again because it makes us look like idiots. It makes us sound like the only thing we want to do is run and hide. I mean, that song said, I see an army. I sing that song and I'm like, Lord, do you really see an army? Do you see an army? Or do you see a lot of people who lay down their arms and just give in? Take a defensive posture. Well, as long as I keep this wall fortified, nobody can get in. Guess what? Throughout the history of man, and you can go research this, it is a fact. There has never, ever been a fortress that was impenetrable. Never. Every culture, every nation, every army, every kingdom that said, this is impenetrable, they met their match one day. Even the Jews had the highest fortress around, Masada. Y'all ever seen the movie, read the book, you know about it? It was impenetrable. And this was truly impenetrable. But the Romans were very tenacious. Does anybody know what they did? No, that's Troy. they did move some machinery, but they had to do something first. See, that siege took a very long time. There was one thing that the Romans had that the Jews didn't. Time. The Jews, see, in a fortress, you have a finite set of supplies. Eventually, those supplies, they run out. And so the Romans had enough time on their hands. And while they were waiting for the supplies to run out, see, their hope was that you were going to starve and die of dehydration first. But if not, we were going to ensure your demise. And so the Romans started bringing in loads of dirt. And eventually they started to build a ramp that started to go all the way up this mountainside called Masada. And they built and built and built. They were very methodical. Guess who they used to build it? Well, the very slaves that didn't get to get into Masada, you know. So the very Jews were building the very method of warfare that was going to defeat the ones that were hidden up there. And then when the Jews were weak, they really didn't have much fight left in them. The Romans finally got to the top, took siege, but there was really no battle to fight because they had the time in their hand. But that's how we as Christians sometimes are. And our enemy has time. We don't have time. The longer we take a defensive posture, we're losing ground. And we're losing time. And that's all he has. He knows where he's going to spend eternity. Nothing's changed for him in the last millennia. It's the same. So I'll leave you with this, though. I want you to kind of think, who is the unknown God that Paul is talking about? Well, in the Old Testament, he's known as Elohim, which is God. El Shaddai, Lord God Almighty. El Elyon, the Most High God. El Olam, the Everlasting God. Yahweh, your Lord, Jehovah. Jehovah Nissi, the Lord, my banner. Jehovah Ra, the Lord, my shepherd. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. Jehovah Sidkenu, the Lord, our righteousness. Jehovah Mekadishkim, the Lord who sanctifies you. Jehovah Jireh, the one who will provide. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is peace. Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts. And Adonai, Lord and Master. That's the unknown God. That's the God that Paul was telling them about. This is the God of gods. Did Paul didn't care about the hundreds and thousands of gods and idols they had. He didn't care that his very life was in danger because he was coming against their most sacred idols and deities. He declared to them the unknown God. In the New Testament, he's known as Theos, God, true, unique, transcendent, and Savior. He's known as Kurios, Lord, supreme authority. He's known as Despotes, master and possessing. And he's known as Abba, Father, Daddy. That's who our God is. That's the unknown God. The same information that Paul had about his God, we possess. Even more so, the same authority that Paul had, we possess. The same wisdom, the same knowledge, the same Jesus, the same Holy Spirit that Paul had to stand before these men, we have. Now, I'm not recommending that you go out to the next courtroom whenever they have a district court in session and go in there and start declaring your God. Not recommending that unless the Holy Spirit tells you to, okay? Or the next time that somebody comes out in a political position or a governmental position or a position of authority and speaks defiantly against your God. I'm not necessarily telling you to go up to them and declare the unknown God to them, okay? I'm not telling you to go do that. But I am going to say that if the Holy Spirit does, don't back down. Don't be afraid. Know who you are. Listen, all these names that I just gave you, they don't refer to a different God. That's not the 12, what I call them? Primordials. It's not the 12 Titans. It's not the 12 Olympians. It's the same God. The creator of the universe. The creator of life. The Greeks couldn't even speak about their gods if it wasn't for God. They would have no concept. Amen? But these are names of the one true God, that he may be known to the world. Not because he's trying to break down idolatry, but in spite of idolatry, he is God. Amen? Amen. So in our lives, listen, if we're not doing a self-evaluation of our lives and how we're walking and the things that distract us, do you know even church can be a distraction? Okay. Now, that's kind of contradictory to what you would hear from most pastors, right? So please, don't everybody take next Sunday off, okay? But I want you to understand that even sometimes, even doing something very faithfully and keeping up with it, sometimes if that's taking us away from the fullness of what God is calling us to, then we need to evaluate that. We need to really look at it. We've had times in our lives, it's like, you know what, we're burnt out. We're done. I love God, but right now I'm not a fan of church. You know? And we've had to take some time off. And I'm not talking about weeks. I'm talking about, you know what? This Wednesday, we're just not going to, or this event on a Tuesday, we're just not going to participate. We just can't. You know? We're done. If we don't have some family time, or we just don't get connected and reach out, it's just, nothing's wrong. I'm not mad. I'm not leaving the church. I'll be back the very next service, but I just got to take this one off. Okay, so what you should be hearing from me is, if you were that type of person, and you, man, you're here every time the door's open, man, everything that needs to be done, you're in it, and you get to a point, I would rather you come and say, James, I just need a break. How long? I need this. You got it. Don't just disappear and don't come back. Okay, and don't just write us off. Man, let's talk about it. Trust me, I do not want anything in our natural life to ever separate us from number one, Christ, number two, the gathering of the saints, and number three, the fulfillment of what he has for us in our walk, okay? We're in this together. Even Jesus had to break away. And even when he broke away, they chased him down. But he even needed those times to recharge. And that's okay. So I hope what you hear from me is everything in our lives, we need to look at it and we need to evaluate it and say, is this keeping me from God? You know, our families could keep us from God. Our children could keep us from God. Our husbands, our wives can keep us from God. Hey, nothing is exempt from being an idol in our life. We just have to look at it and understand, am I consuming more of my energy and resources and time in this one area, and it's distracting me from what God is calling me to do, or distracting me from my relationship from God? If I can't pray because I'm running, going everything, something's wrong. If I can't read my word because I'm running, something's wrong. Likewise, if I can't spend time with this woman who is my other half, I'm incomplete without her because I'm doing other things, even if it's for the kingdom, something is wrong. We can't continue doing our relationship like this. We got to be able to find the balance, okay? Let's pray. Father, I thank you that your word is true, and let every man be a liar. I thank you, Lord, that we, even in 2016, we have so many distractions in our life. We have so many things that are pulling at us. We don't have idols in the streets. We don't have idols on our mantle, Father God, but we do have things that separate us from you. So this morning, Lord, I just want us to just do an inventory of what we're investing in. All of us, what are we investing in? Is that investment of time? Is that investment of resources? Is that investment of energy? Is it getting us to the next place that you are calling us to? Or is it distracting us and keeping us under the devil's thumb, keeping us under his will because we are separating from you? Lord, only you know those things in our lives, and only you can reveal them. I can't. I'm inventorying the things that are in James, and that's all I have the energy for. That's all I have the bandwidth for, Father, and I am no one's judge, nor are we anyone's judge of each other. So, Lord, individually, I just speak now that, Father, that your Holy Spirit will just convict us and love us and reveal to us so that we can be focused on the right things and we can direct all of our energy and our resources to those things, Father God, for the fulfillment of your kingdom, the fulfillment of everything that you have for us. And I thank you this morning. In Jesus' name, and all who receive said, amen. Thank you. Y'all are dismissed.